before giving you my own perspectives on Ladson, it's probably only fair that I present to you a brief sketch of his professional life. This particular sketch is not my own, and that can be found online in our brochure for the new school. It reads, Ladson was trained in psychiatry at Stanford and graduated from the C.G. Jung Institute of San Francisco in 1975. He has written, taught, and lectured on a variety of topics and is a member of the Society of Jungian Analysts of Northern California and the Institute for Contemporary Psychoanalysis in Los Angeles. In 2009, he received an award for distinguished contributions to psychoanalytic education from the International Forum for Psychoanalytic Education. He is a member of the editorial board of the Journal of Analytical Psychology. He practices psychoanalysis and clinical consultation in Seattle. And all of this, of course, is perfectly true, but it really doesn't give you a sense of many other things that Ladson has accomplished. Personally, I think of Ladson as a proprietor in a shop of ideas. I call this Ladson's shop. The shop contains all manner of books, papers, literature, movies, and art, and of course, he has written many of the papers himself. All of these invite the reader and the visitor to consider provocative and challenging ideas. These ideas have the effect, in my opinion, of challenging conditioned thinking and the tendency some of us have to ease back into the status quo. In addition to seeing Ladson as the owner of the shop, I also think of him as an explorer, someone who is always setting out on a new ocean voyage to discover unknown continents. As a result, he offers the type of curiosity that can lead to what I would describe as greater integrity in living. As you listen to the talk he is about to give, I believe you'll agree with me that his ideas are a significant contribution to the goal of becoming a more ethical person. In our current world, where we are more and more trying to figure out man or monster, we need Ladson's questions more than ever. I will now shut up and allow Ladson to speak for himself.
Thank you, Tony. That was very, very appreciated. Well, it's wonderful to be here today, and all the arrangements, and Ken, and Sharon, and Robin, and Tony have made it such a nice environment, a containing environment, beautiful view, and of course, it's always so wonderful, too, to have my son here, and nothing more rewarding in life than to have a wonderful son. I'm lucky to have three, but I'm wonderful to have one right here on the scene with me. And thank you for being here, coming out on a quiet, meditative Saturday. I suppose this is not a bad place to meditate together, and we'll talk some, but in kind of a quiet, reflective way, I suppose. So without you, there'd be no meeting. So thanks for coming. I think our talks will jibe to some extent. I don't even know what, there are obviously all kinds of interconnections and dimensions, and that's a whole different subject. We could figure out what they are, but maybe that'll be part of the process too, that I think there's a lot of coincidence, which it was coincidental. We planned our talk separately. We didn't decide ahead of time what we were going to talk about and then figure out how they went. We didn't decide, but we just did them separately, and then we saw that they were coinciding. So the title of my talk, as I guess you know, is Trauma, Shame, and Shifts in Ethical Consciousness in Joseph Conrad's Large Gem. We live in troubling times. As Alex has discussed, our need to control the noise of experience makes us prone to look for simplistic solutions. Confronted with the human and the monstrous, our minds tend to shut down when we see how often these categories coincide rather than differentiate. Impacted by the heart of darkness that is part of the human condition. We blame evil leaders, devilish plots, and dangerous minorities. We struggle to find ways to live with experiences that are on the edge of the incomprehensible and still retain our capacity for reflection. The shame of being human, of mere being human, tends to overwhelm us, the shame of it. The truth of uncanny events exceeds our capacity to think and reflect, and we struggle to resist the temptation of cynicism or rage that turn us into that which we despise. In order to gain a little reflective distance regarding this rending ambivalence and maintain a capacity for thoughtfulness, it can be very useful to engage works of art such as Joseph Conrad's Lord Jim. The novel is a tale of trauma, shame, and the monstrous, a portrayal of man's search for a more profound ethical stance in the world. Published in 1900, the same year as Freud's interpretation of dreams, the industrial age was reaching its prime, epitomized by the speed and power of railways. There was extensive demolishing and reconstruction of cities to accommodate these mighty steel vehicles and to control and organize workers for mass production. The creation of broad boulevards also discouraged rebellion. As the intimate spaces of the cities of the Western world were being demolished, the symptoms of agoraphobia emerged. The screams and cries of the suffering women in the Salpêtrière Asylum in Paris deeply influenced Freud's development. World wars and genocides were soon to come. Lord Jim seems especially suited to our times of moral confusion and shamelessness. Jim's search for deeper ethical ground is also our search. As the narrative voice in the novel intermittently says, "He was one of us. He is one of us, I would say. He was one of us. He is one of us. Jim is us." Conrad was born into the midst of political violence, and that strongly shaped his view of the world. He was the only son of Polish aristocrats. Because of the family's opposition to the occupying Russians, they were banished to Siberia when he was 4 years old. His mother died there, and his father died when he was 12. Conrad went to sea as a young man and made it his career. A bit like Hamlet and his ghostly specter, he was sometimes haunted by the shame of abandoning the fight for Polish independence. After being credentialed as a ship's master, he left that profession and became a full-time writer in English, his third language. He drew heavily on his experiences with men and the sea, and with the many cultures that he encountered. The great iron ships that he directed were the instruments of imperialism, empire, and the colonial mentality that he disdained. And many of his writings involve the mysteries of the sea and the perturbations of its human voyagers. That is the setting for his great novel, Lord Jim. It is the story of a man's struggle to live with honor amidst the shaming and monstrous dimensions of life. We first see the idealistic young Jim in his early maritime training, where he was noted to be very smart aloft, but looking down on others from above. When down below with the others, he immersed himself in light literature, keeping separate, seeing himself as a hero in romantic heroic dramas. In his imaginary world, he was always an example of devotion to duty and as unflinching as a hero in a book. However, when a real chance to participate in a heroic rescue in fact occurred, he failed to act in time. At first this bothered him, but he soon rationalized his behavior and went on with his training to become a ship's officer. The author raises questions about the romantic view of life and problems of character. Is Jim foredoomed to fail at crucial moments the rest of his life due to some tragic flaw, a childlike idealism that can never come to fruition? What are the tragic limits of our freedom, and how much is due to fate? In the early time of his career at sea, after his training, Jim was injured by a falling spar during a storm and entered a period of torment and despair from that trauma of encountering, to quote, elemental furies that are coming at him with a purpose of malice, with a strength beyond control, with an unbridled cruelty that means to tear out of him his hope, which means to smash, to destroy, to annihilate all that he had seen, known, loved, or enjoyed, or hated. An uncontrollable rush of anguish would grip him bodily, make him gasp and writhe under the blankets. The unintelligent brutality of existence filled him with a despairing desire to escape at any cost. Then fine weather returned, and he thought about it no more. After this early traumatic crisis, he seemed to have made a choice between returning home to a predictable world of sober duty, home to England, and something else. This something else was the prevailing romantic view of the, quote, exotic East, with a colonial life of relative ease. He gave up the idea of returning to his home culture and took a berth as first officer on the ship, the Patna. The Patna was a local steamer, as old as the hills, lean like a greyhound and eaten up with rust worse than a condemned water tank, painted outside and whitewashed inside to appear presentable. It was engaged by 800 pilgrims going to Mecca and commanded by a renegade German who brutalized all those he was not afraid of. As the pilgrims streamed aboard the ship over three gangways, urged by faith and the hope of paradise, the skipper's initial comment to Jim, his new first mate, was, "Look at these cattle." His monstrous visage conveyed another underlying dimension of life on the Patna. Red of face, only half awake, the left eye partly closed, the right staring stupid and glassy, he hung his big head over the chart and scratched his ribs sleepily. There was something obscene in the sight of his naked flesh. The odious and fleshy figure fixed itself in Jim's memory forever as an incarnation of everything vile and base that lurks in the world we love. The ship's engineer, indeed, also later proved to be psychotic, imagining in terror that the ship was full of reptiles and there were millions of pink toads under his bed. The contrast between Jim's idyllic imaginations and the reality of the ship and the men around him was stark. A few days into the voyage, the engineer was drunkenly arguing with the captain when there was a gigantic jolt that pitched him down head first. Jim and the captain staggered forward and saw only the calm sea and a clear sky above. A faint sound like a remote thunder came and went, and the whole ship quivered. The sharp hull seemed to rise a few inches in succession through its full length and settled again rigidly. Then all was quiet once more. They had evidently run into an old hulk lying half submerged in the water. Jim rushed forward to see what was happening, and he found that the bow was dipping into the sea, and the rusty iron bulkhead was bulging, apparently ready to give way. There were 800 people aboard and only 7 lifeboats, and the crew feared a panic if they informed the passengers. Jim was considering the options when he discovered the rest of the crew were already launching one of the lifeboats to abandon ship and abandon the pilgrims. Jim later claimed that he was not afraid of death and had not planned to join them, but to stay with the ship, as was his duty. He stood stock still by the hatch, expecting the ship to sink under his feet at any moment, imagining with horror a crowd of silent bodies laid out for death, the pilgrims they were transporting. One of the escaping crew stepped backward suddenly, clutched at the air with raised arms, tottered and collapsed. The man had in fact dropped dead, but no one was aware of it. Then, as the crew detached the lifeboat from the ship, they cried out to the fallen man. Jim described the scene. "I heard a wild screech as if I had been at the top of a tower. Jump! George! Jump!" Later, he blurted out to Marlowe, who had become his interlocutor, "Instead of George, I had jumped. I knew nothing about it until I looked up and saw the hull of the ship rising above me. She seemed higher than a wall. She looked like a cliff over the boat. I wished I could die. There was no going back. It was as if I had jumped into a black well, into an everlasting deep hole." Indeed, in some sense, he had. The enigma of his act became the shame-ridden core of the rest of his life, a horror that his mind endlessly struggled to assimilate. And yet, it is also true that in his shame, he was one of us. He was one of us. Jim's trauma lies at the basis of the rest of this discussion, and it's useful to consider what the word trauma means. I like this definition. A trauma is an event without necessity. A cause for the subject is an accidental, contingent event, an event without immediate purpose, an event that does not make sense, or rather a senseless event that has to be made sense of, an event that hereafter will be made the foundation of sense. It's probably worth reading a second time. A trauma is an event without necessity, a cause for the subject as an accidental contention event, an event without immediate purpose, an event that does not make sense, or rather a senseless event that has to be made sense of, an event that hereafter will be made the foundation of sense. Struggling with dehiscence again, I think, here too. That is, trauma is the enigmatic foundation of who we are, and it usually involves deep shame and a sense of a monstrous encounter. Our ethical substance, or lack of it, stems from how we deal with the trauma that is inherent to being in the world. There are broader historical features to our lives and traumas that we can sometimes glimpse. Greg Mogensen sees Jim's discovery of the breach in the hull of the Patna and his failure to act as a dutiful ship's officer should as the rupture in the soul itself, a rupture in the soul itself, a rent in the very foundation of our times that was becoming visible. The explicit guidelines of duty stemming from religious and mythological structures were losing their containing authority. As Derrida states, the future is necessarily monstrous. All experience open to the future is prepared or prepares itself to welcome the monstrous thing that is to come, to curd hospitality to that which is absolutely foreign or strange. This is the movement of culture. After the death of God, we all live in our breached vessels, becoming psychological problems to ourselves. Jim took his failure at first as his personal shame, but he also seemed to sense a deeper enigma, some more profound dimensions of his experience, his jump without a cause. The remainder of the novel involves his search for a deeper truth, something reflecting an ethic beyond sober rules and prescribed duties. Jim was deeply ashamed to find himself in the lifeboat in the company of the monstrous captain and the other crew. Those men were themselves shocked and angry upon discovering it was Jim and not their friend George who was with them. The men in the lifeboat were soon picked up by another ship and taken to port, where they learned that the Patna had indeed not sunk. When they got back to port, the Patna had been towed in by a French gunboat that found it floating about aimlessly. This demolished the crew's romantic story they were going to give of being survivors of a terrible disaster. Jim recalled that he had heard anguished cries for help as they left on the lifeboat, but those cries had clearly been figments of his romantic imagination. The romantic tragedy had almost turned now into a shameful farce. Jim and his fellows on the lifeboat now appeared to be irresponsible clowns. This was not the usual romantic tale of adventure on the high seas. There was to be an official hearing, a sort of trial, with much at stake for the crew of the Patna. Marlowe became the narrator of the story at this point. Much of the story already told came from Marlowe, who was the carrier of Jim's memory throughout much of the story. He was an experienced ship's captain himself and somewhat senior to Jim. Jim's personality and his fate publicly engaged the fascinated attention of many, because they seemed to sense, at some intuitive level, that his struggles had a special relevance beyond the merely personal, that their entire worldview was in doubt. Later, Marlowe reflected upon his own interest in Jim. "I can't explain. I have a distinct notion that I wanted to find something for the laying to rest of the uneasy doubts, more chilling than the certitude of death. The doubt that there is a sovereign power and throne and a fixed standard of conduct." At a break in the hearing, Jim first met Marlowe, and they almost came to blows. Outside the courtroom, a feral yellow dog was running loose, and someone stumbled over him, saying with a laugh, "Look at that wretched cur." Jim heard those words and spun around, stopped Marlowe, and asked in a low, angry, intense voice, "Did you speak to me?" That is, he thought that Marlowe had called him a cur, a sort of despicable animal, almost a monstrous image. Jim was very angry amidst his profoundly visible shame. He continued to aggressively accuse Marlowe of insulting him, despite his disclaimers and protestations. "Now that you see I'm not afraid, you try to crawl out of it," Jim angrily persisted. "Who's a cur now?" Then Marlowe understood and simply just pointed at the nearby dog. Then Jim saw. The red of Jim's fair sunburnt complexion deepened suddenly under the down of his cheeks, invaded his forehead, spread to the roots of his curly hair. His ears became intensely crimson, and even the clear blue of his eyes was darkened many shades by the rush of blood to his head. In the words of Sylvan Tompkins, one of the great theorists of shame, "Shame is so close to the experienced self because the self lives in the face, and within the face, the self burns brightest in the eyes. Shame turns the attention of the self and others to this most visible residence of the self, increases its visibility, and thereby generates the torment of self-consciousness. Our red-faced shame reveals the truth of uncanny breaches in ordinary reality." There's much to think about in terms of shame, the gaze, and the eyes. The other officers of the Patna skipped town, avoiding the Board of Inquiry. Jim will have none of that and confronted the hearing determinedly, but with little satisfaction. He explained to Marlowe, "They wanted facts, facts. They demanded facts as if facts could explain anything. The intent of the hearing focused on guilt, on violations of duty, in concrete, rational-seeming detail. Guilt tends to delineate formal wrongs to others within a context that's known, and possible reparations, while shame brings into question one's deeper relation to those happenings, one's place in a world where one feels excruciatingly visible. Shame experience ranges from the most primitive to something that can touch ontological questions about the individual's very place in the universe. In a sense, guilt is the small inroad into responsibility that is visible to reason and may be a way of paying off or avoiding a more threatening shame. This is how the hearing seemed to Jim, and he would have none of that. He was intent on discovering deeper layers of his experience, and that is what gives his story stature and significance. Marlowe reflected, "It seems to me that I was being made to comprehend the inconceivable." The major figure on the board of inquiry was Captain Brierley, who seemed to be the perfect model of ship captain. He wanted every detail pinned down. In the face of his perfection, everyone around him felt a strange inferiority. He was the epitome of duty fulfilled. And yet, he could not bear the sight of Jim's testimony. Soon afterwards, Brierley mysteriously committed suicide, meticulously planned, fitting the way he lived. The author speculates that his suicide may have been provoked because Jim's story breached his defenses, bringing back overwhelming memories of his own secret flaws or indiscretions. The crab was smashed open. Brierley also seemed to reflect a simpler era in a broader sense that was passing away into a future when the guidelines of duty that stem from transcendent moral imperatives would no longer be possible, a time when the containing frameworks of myth and religion would lose their authority, and the heart of darkness would become more grossly apparent. After being found guilty at the hearing and losing his credential as a ship's officer, Jim came to Marlowe's hotel room in great anguish. Marlowe decided that he would try to help him in his time of difficulty, feeling that it is when we try to grapple with another man's intimate need that we perceive how incomprehensible, wavering, and misty are the beings that share with us the sight of the stars and the warmth of the sun. Marlowe talked with Jim first about the material aspects of his condition. "You must live," he told Jim, who responded, "That isn't the thing." He made it clear that self-preservation was not the bottom line for him. Marlowe offered Jim money and a letter of recommendation to a man who owed him a favor. He was at first reluctant to accept this offer, generous offer, but then understood that Marlowe's intentions stem from a concern for him and his quest for a new start. In the years that followed, Jim became very successful and well-liked at a series of jobs, but always fled the scene whenever a person or rumor from the past surfaced. He was daring in his work of meeting ships as they arrived, sometimes showing disregard for his own survival, and people often remark about his childlike openness. In the light of Jim's repetitive pattern of success and flight, Marlowe decides to consult a man named Stein, a wealthy and respected merchant who was noted for his wide experience and his avocation of entomology. Upon arriving at Stein's home, Marlowe found him inside, contemplating the beauty of one of his butterflies. He was a famous collector worldwide. Greeting Marlowe, he exclaimed, "Marvelous, and look at the accuracy, the harmony, and so fragile and so strong and so exact. This is nature, the balance of colossal forces. Every star is so, and every blade of grass and so, and the mighty cosmos in perfect equilibrium produces this masterpiece, this beautiful, perfect butterfly. And Marlowe replied cheerfully and teasingly, "Masterpiece, but what of man?" Stein responded, "Man is amazing, but he is not a masterpiece. Perhaps the divine artist was a little mad, huh? Sometimes it seems to me that man has come to where he is not wanted, where there is no place for him. For if not, why should he always be running around wanting something more? Why should he run about here and there, making a great noise about himself, talking about the stars and disturbing the blades of grass?" Marlowe told Stein that he had come with a specimen, Jim, and told him the story. Stein responded, "I understand very well. He is romantic." Marlowe questioned further, "What's good for it?" Stein lifted up a long forefinger and said, "There is only one remedy. One thing alone can cure." After a pause, Marlowe responded, "Yes, but strictly speaking, the question is not how to get cured, but how to live." Stein nodded approvingly and sympathetically, perhaps a little sadly. "How to be? Ach, how to be?" Then he expanded further. "A man that is born falls into a dream, like a man who falls into the sea. If he tries to climb out into the air, as inexperienced people attempt to do, he drowns. Nicht wahr? No, I tell you. The way is to the destructive element. Submit yourself to the destructive element. Submit yourself. And with the exertions of your hands and feet in the water, make the deep, deep sea keep you up. In the destructive element immerse. That is the way," he repeated. Marlowe had a strong subjective reaction to these words and reflected, "Jim's imperishable reality came to me with a convincing and irresistible force. We had approached nearer to absolute truth, which, like beauty itself, floats elusive, obscure, half-submerged in the silent, still waters of mystery." Marlowe and Stein made plans to assist Jim on the next chapter of his journey. Still with me out there? Okay. Stein had personal connections in a small, isolated island called Patusan, and planned to appoint Jim as his new agent there. Colonial powers did not control that area. Jim would be replacing a Portuguese man named Cornelius, whom Stein described in very dubious terms as entitled and full of resentment. To an extent, placing Jim in Patusan was an experiment by Stein to see what this enigmatic fellow with such a strange and potent history could become. "Once Jim got in," he said, "it would be for the outside world as though he had never existed." This fresh opportunity indeed appealed strongly to Jim. He said he could finally slam the door on the past. When Marlowe asked whether he would ever return to the world he had known, he exclaimed, "Never." Stein gave Jim a ring that was a symbol of friendship with Doraemon, a significant traditional leader in Patusan. They had been old war comrades, Stein and Doraemon, and it was a symbol of eternal friendship. And Stein had once saved Doraemon's life. Thus Jim became kind of an heir to a history of courage, honor, and friendship that endured. The ring seemed to embody virtues that transcended time, race, or culture. Jim thereby entered a new phase of his life, now on land. 2 years later, Marlowe came to Potosan to visit Jim. After he landed, he quickly discovered that the local people now called him Tuan Jim, or Lord Jim, and spoke of him with awe. Jim told Marlowe his story. After landing, he had persuaded some local people to take him upriver to the town of Potosan. They had been very reluctant because they greatly feared a local administrative power, the Raja, Tunku Atlang. Sure enough, a crowd of armed men had swarmed around him as soon as he arrived there, but he offered no resistance, and he gave them his unloaded revolver. They told him that the Raja wanted to see him, and he told them, "All right, I too want to see the Raja, and here I am." They kept him prisoner in a filthy shed in the courtyard for 3 days, while the Raja and his men deliberated his fate. They questioned him periodically and then asked, incidentally, whether he could repair a clock. They viewed Europeans as masters of the technology of the times and as part of their power. Jim undertook the task as a diversion. As he worked on the clock, a sudden awareness of his peril came upon him. All at once, without any mental process, as it were, without any stir of emotion, he set about his escape as if executing a plan that had matured for a month. Jim left the shed, entered a courtyard, ran past a dignitary with armed guards who was indeed coming to question him again, and leapt over the palisades surrounding the whole compound. However, there was a very muddy creek separating the compound from the town that was his goal. That was where Doraman lived. He became deeply stuck in a deep pit of soft and sticky mud, although there was higher and drier ground a few feet above him. He reached and grabbed desperately with his hands and only succeeded in gathering a horrible, cold, shiny heap of slime against his breast up to the very chin. It seemed to him that he was burying himself alive, and then he struck out madly, scattering the mud with his fists. It fell on his head, on his face, over his eyes, and into his mouth. He made tremendous sobbing, grasping efforts that seemed to burst his eyeballs and make him blind, culminating into one mighty supreme effort in the darkness to crack the earth asunder, to throw it off his limbs, and he felt himself now creeping up on the dry bank. Then, as he pelted straight through the town in his socks, besplattered with filth out of all semblance to a human being, he ran into a group of several startled men and had just breath enough to gasp out, "Doraman! Doraman!" The men half carried him to the top of the hill and took him into a vast enclosure full of palms and fruit trees. In the midst of the hubbub sat a massive man with great dignity of bearing, Doraman. He managed to produce the ring from Stein, and they began to care for him. He was safe. He had literally immersed himself in the destructive element and kept swimming, just as Stein had described. He had crossed the boundary between being a puerile romantic, a childish idealist, and a man with the capacity to face the heart of darkness. Doraman, for whom Stein's ring was the talisman of friendship, was a respected chief of a group from the Celebes. Marlowe described him as remarkable. He was a huge man who seemed monumental rather than fat. His impassive repose was like a display of dignity, and his ponderous movements were like manifestations of a mighty, deliberate force. His hospitality for Jim conjured a picture of primal virtue during a barbarous time. In addition to Doraman's group and the Raja's group, there's a third faction of wild men in the hills above the town, led by a half-Arab named Sharif Ali. Using religion, he had incited the tribes of the interior of the island. Those divisions had created chronic chaos, destruction, and injustice. As things evolved in Patusan, Jim and Dane Waris, Dorman's only child, became close friends. They also became war comrades when Jim later devised a means of taking the fort of Sharif Ali in the hills, freeing the people from the raids and barbaric acts. Afterwards, Jim became the virtual ruler of Patusan, even appointing the headman in conjunction with Dane Waris. Cornelius was the man whom Jim had partly replaced as Stein's agent, and Jewel was his stepdaughter. Cornelius was filled with envy and resentment, but Jim and Jewel fell in love and became inseparable. She watched over him carefully, gave him advice, and on occasion warned of assassination plots against him. Jim exuded confidence to Marlowe, saying, "I feel that if I go straight, nothing can touch me." And Marlowe was convinced that he at last mastered his fate. However, on the way out, he encountered Cornelius once more, who was still full of envy and hatred, saying scornfully that Jim was no more than a little child, a little child. Marlowe needed to return to his everyday world, and he and Jim movingly expressed their friendship while acknowledging that they might never meet again. As they were being paddled to the landing by two local people, Marlowe, deeply moved, had a vision that the immensity of the outspread sea, the stillness of the coast, passing north and south beyond the limits of my vision, made up one colossal presence, watching us four dwarfs, isolated on a strip of glistening sand. As the schooner pulled away from the dock, Marlowe watched as Jim's figure slowly faded away in the distance and later recalled, "For me, the white figure in the stillness of the coast and sea seemed to stand at the heart of a vast enigma." The twilight was ebbing from the sky above his head. The strip of sand had sunk already under his feet. He himself appeared no bigger than a child, than only a speck, a tiny white speck that seemed to catch all the light left in a darkened world. And suddenly, I lost him. The story continued sometime later, in a different sort of way, narrated by a bundle of letters that Marlowe sent to an unknown recipient. In one letter, Marlowe described a recent traumatic visit to his friend Stein. On the way to Stein's house, he had encountered one of Jim's most faithful supporters from Patusan, Tommy Tan, and asked, "Is Tuan Jim inside?" "No," the man answered, and then blurted out, "He would not fight, he would not fight." Entering Stein's room, Marlowe asked what was the matter. Stein spoke with great perturbation. "She is here. She is here. Come this way. Young hearts are unforgiving." It was Jewel who recognized him at once, and she said quietly, "He has left me. You always leave us for your own ends. It would have been easy to die with him, but he would not. Ah, you foreigners are hard, treacherous, without truth, without compassion." Stein suddenly broke in with anguish, "No, no, no, my poor child." He patted her hand, lying passively on his sleeve. "You don't understand. Ach, why do you not understand?" Marlowe's final narrative followed. The ending had begun with a man called Brown, or more sarcastically, Gentleman Brown. The son of an English baronet, he seemed to be the moral antipode to Jim. Brown was a buccaneer, but he was distinguished from his fellows by the arrogant temper of his misdeeds in a vehement scorn for mankind at large, or for his victims in particular. The other buccaneers were merely vulgar and greedy brutes, but he seemed moved by some complex intentions. He would rob a man as if only to demonstrate his poor opinion of the creature, and would bring to the shooting or maiming of some quiet, unoffending stranger a savage and vengeful earnestness fit to terrify the most reckless of desperadoes. And thus this man sailed into Jim's history, a blind accomplice of the dark powers. Brown and his small crew, desperately fleeing the danger of prison at the time, ended by going upriver to Potosan town in search of supplies and plunder. They were starving and desperate. Jim was away on a mission at the time. When the motley crew reached the town, there was an uproar, and they were confronted by defenders mustered by Dane Waris and Jewel. Seeing they were outnumbered, they retreated to a knoll nearby and set up a defense. Jewel and Dane Waris wanted to finish off the pirates, but the rest were reluctant. There was a pause, and the manipulative Cornelius, as well as the Rajah's emissary, began to scheme and palaver. Brown was filled with rage and hatred because his desire for power and plunder had been thwarted. Cornelius filled his mind with information about the political situation in Potosan and encouraged Brown to kill Jim. Then Jim returned and the situation confronted him. An ancient question soon emerged. What can one do with the manipulative psychopaths who have no shame? Marlowe had interviewed Brown on his deathbed when his character and emotions emerged with a primal rawness. Marlowe interviewing Brown on his own when Brown's deathbed. The man had hated Jim from the first sight. Jim was not the man he had expected to see, a man with whom he could cut a deal. He cursed him for his youth and assurance, his clear eyes and his untroubled bearing. Ironically, when they confronted each other, it was at the very spot, the divide where Jim had taken the second desperate leap of his life, the leap into the destructive element, the muddy struggle that had landed him into the midst of the life of Potosan, into the trust and love of the people. Marlowe described Brown as monstrous. He was terrible, relating this to me, this tortured skeleton of a man drawn up together with his face over his knees upon a miserable bed in that wretched hovel, and lifting his head to look at me with malignant glee. I knew just what to say, Brown gloated. His debilitated body shook with an exultation so vehement, so assured, and so malicious that it seemed to have driven off the death waiting for him. He valued his illusion of having trampled all the earth under his feet, the world that had shamed and banished him, and that brought him a perverse comfort. However, for a moment, Marlowe reflected upon an old story that Gentleman Brown had once run off with a dying woman and cried like a baby when she finally died. Apparently, he had no shame, but there was a small hint of tragic complexity in his character as well. Brown was extremely cunning about finding the soft and vulnerable places in people's character, and he accomplished that with Jim. Marlowe remarked that it was as if a demon had been whispering advice in his ear. In the vernacular of an interrogator at Tool Sling, one could say that Brown had an uncanny knack for laying bare the shit inside the crab. When Jim asked Brown, he said, well, what made you come here? Brown responded, hunger. And what made you? Jim responded immediately by becoming very red in the face. Then Brown continued by cunningly and intuitively asking Jim Well, didn't he himself understand that when it came to saving one's life, one just didn't care how many others perished? 3,000? Who cared? Once again reminding Jim of his shame of the Patna. The facts had been unknown to Brown, but he had a demonic intuition of how to manipulate people. Finally, Jim asked him, "Well, will you promise to leave the coast and surrender your arms?" Brown vehemently refused the idea of surrendering their weapons. "Oh, very well," Jim finally agreed. "You shall have a clear road or a clear fight." He conferred with Old Doorman, and Brown's exit was planned. Dane Warese would lead a group down the river to be sure that Brown and his men indeed followed through. Later, Jim entrusted his ring to his own loyal follower, Tommy Tan, to take to Dane Warese to reassure him it was okay to let Brown through now. However, Cornelius was infuriated that Brown had not killed Jim and then treacherously then told him of an alternate route down the river that would pass behind Dane Warese's encampment. Brown was all too happy to have a chance for revenge as he escaped, and Cornelius agreed to guide Brown's boat down the little-known passage. As they approached Dane Warese's camp from behind, Cornelius gave the word to load, and they attacked. It was a total surprise. Jim's message had advised them that all was well, and no one had expected Brown would know about the alternate passage. 14 shots rang out at one, as one, then a second and a third volley. Dane Warese was shot in the forehead. Then the men retired as they had come, escaping to their ship at the mouth of the river. However, Tommy Tan killed Cornelius before he could escape and returned to the town as fast as he could to bring the awful news. When he reached the town, he shouted out very quickly, "They have killed Dane Warese and many more." Then he encountered Jim, who said, speak out, is he dead?" Tommy Tan cried out, "It was a most cruel treachery. He ran out at the first shots and fell." Jim immediately understood. He'd retreated from one world, and now the other, the work of his own hands, had fallen in ruins around him. He sat a long time at the table where he had conducted the affairs of his world. Jewel begged him to fight for his life, but he remained inflexible. Jim stood looking at the river, and Jewel was looking at him across the yard. She cried out, "Will you fight?" And he answered, "There is nothing to fight for." Then she cried out, "Will you flee?" He replied, "There is no escape." She could not understand that Jim was going to prove his power in another way and conquer the final fatal destiny itself. "Open the gates," he ordered. When Dane Warese's body was brought back to Doorman's place of residence, the grieving father sat staring at it for a long time, staring at the body. Someone took the well-known ring from his dead son's hand and held it up, and there was a murmur from the crowd. Doorman stared at it and suddenly let out one great fierce cry deep from the chest, a roar of pain and fury, as strong as a wounded bull, bringing great fear by the magnitude of his anger and his sorrow. When Jim reached Doorman's area, the people he met seemed awestruck and hastily stood aside to let him pass. The venerable patriarch sat in his armchair, immense and desolate, with a pair of flintlock pistols on his knees, surrounded by an armed throng. Jim stood silent before him for a time, then came up, looked at his dead friend, lifted the sheet, then dropped it without a word, He came, ran from lip to lip. He hath taken it upon his own head. Jim heard that and responded, yes, upon my head. After a few moments, he said gently to Dorman, I am come in sorrow. I come ready and unarmed. From the throat of the unwieldy old man came gurgling, choking, inhuman sounds, and his two attendants helped him stand from behind. The ring, the talisman that had opened so many doors, reportedly dropped from Dorman's lap and rolled to Jim's feet. Then, while Jim stood stiffened, with his bared head in the light of the torches, looking Dorman straight into the face, the older man lifted his arm deliberately and shot his friend through the chest. They say that the white man sent a proud and unflinching glance right and left at all those faces. Then, with his hand over his lips, he fell forward, dead. So, what are we to make of this ending, and what enigma did this final gesture point toward? It's so emotional, it makes it hard to think. The contrast between Jim's original great test and his last test initially stood out to me. In the earlier event, he was transporting pilgrims on the Putnam without much sense of personal connection, indulging endless romantic, childish fantasies about heroism in the sea. A life of languid ease as ship's officer in exotic shores seemed in his future, a moral cesspool of expat decadence. The jolt of the crisis and the excruciating shame and enigma of his jump ensued. In his quest to understand that shameful act, its enigmatic monstrousness became a sort of teacher, an agent of transformation. At the hearing, the first hint of the emergence of an unusual destiny became evident. He was angry that all the board wanted to do was learn the facts connected with guilt. Jim indeed wanted something more, and it required that he bear and acknowledge his shame, although he initially took it mainly as a merely personal affair without a larger meaning. He feared that he had become like a mongrel, a cur to others. As things developed, he displayed an unusual capacity to bear shame and not go under. The perfect Brierly committed suicide after the public expression of Jim's shameful breach of dirty duty, as if he could not even bear the thought of such things. In stark contrast to Jim's strength of fidelity to his process, wherever it might lead. At the core, Jim's freedom mainly consisted of embracing his shame and the haunting enigma of his act. In the destructive element immerse, as Stein put it, the point is to experience the heart of darkness for what it is while maintaining one's integrity. Mogensen quotes Hegel's description of this process as tarrying with the negative, tarrying with the negative. In Hegel's view, the life of the spirit is such that it wins its truth only when, in utter dismemberment, it finds itself. The life of the spirit is such that it wins its truth only when, in utter dismemberment, maybe dehiscence, it finds itself. This seems to involve dwelling with the reality of the monstrous, with full consciousness, while not being controlled by it or taking refuge in simplistic solutions and escapes. Thinking in terms of man or monster, it's the demanding task of experiencing the redacted, and facing dehiscence, the possibility of psychic fragmentation, while maintaining an integrity of being and an awareness of the face of the other. This attitude also resembles what psychoanalysis calls the sublime. It's very different than transcendence or getting beyond something. In this way, a merely personal shame may evolve into an ontological shame, awareness of our intrinsic flaws and limitations in the face of a vast universe. That is what the human race shares, the universal particular that we all share. One of Marlowe's final observations was that Jim had no dealings with any but himself, and at the last had a faith mightier than the law of ardor and progress. At the end, he refused to escape with Jules. He does not fight. He does not commit suicide, and he does not run back to England. He embraced the penumbra of the unknown, tarrying with the negative. Dorman seemed to be the incarnation of a reservoir of primal human virtue, and Jim's death felt like an affirmation of an almost knightly honor of friendship and keeping faith. He died amidst a community he loved and which loved and admired him. In my view, he didn't know what the outcome would be when he went to meet Dorman, but died in a spontaneous creative act, a free act, that resulted in preserving the community. He seemed to have had awareness of what not to do, not pretending to know the future. That seemed to involve humbly accepting that, paradoxically, lack of knowledge of what will happen lies at the core of human freedom. Anticipating an event would be, in some sense, to determine it, to know something about it, to anticipate what it is indeed impossible to anticipate. Freedom stems from a hole in being that often feels shaming and like an opening to the monstrous. We are not perfect butterflies going along a pre-planned course, and we do not control the future. Jim had been an apprentice to shame and not knowing for many years, and in my view, his death should be seen in that perspective. It had true nobility. Readers and scholars endlessly speculate how things could have been different and tend to analyze and theorize about his failure to get beyond his trauma and sometimes the opposite, seeing him as an all-knowing ubermensch. However, I understand him in a third way, using a bit of a Lacanian lens, as acting out of a responsible not knowing. This is more difficult to accept because it is messy, and because we all long, on some level, to be the perfect butterfly. Thank you.
So now we're going to take some time, about 15 minutes, for a question and answer. And when you take the microphone, please stand up and speak loudly into it so we can all hear. Thanks.
What he's talking about, really touches on this. It's like how rare people actually do stand up to their moral convictions. For instance, we all think that we're moral and everything. But how many of us would do what Edward Snowden did? He was one of 1.3 million people had his security clearance. In my opinion, he did the moral thing, but how many people would do that? How many people would actually become a whistleblower and throw away their lives? That's kind of what Lord Jim did. Towards the end, he reached this point that he wasn't that way earlier in his life.
I would, I really don't feel comfortable answering a question like that or trying to, because I'd have to interview him in detail and so forth and so on. Just speaking in terms of newspapers and stuff, I could see that both sides of it. I mean, it was, courageous and all that in a certain sense. In another sense, I would think if he was you know, truly had deep integrity, he would have stayed and dealt with it and brought out those same ideas in a court of law and spoken to, you know, what place he was coming from and fought for the legitimacy and integrity in his own community, in his own setting. So in one way, I felt he flew and got off the hook and tried to be a hero. On the other hand, you know, it was useful. I could see that both sides of it. So I couldn't redact it. You could redact it either way.
Yeah.
But both ways, I'll do it both ways.
Yeah. Yes.
Thank you, first of all. A couple of quotes or a couple of things you mentioned struck me that seemed connected with your son's talk, and that is the quote about facts. Facts, what do they really show? As if we can explain any one person. And I think at the end of Lord Jim, there are letters that are written from various people giving their perspectives of Jim, of what happened, and they sort of add to the complexity of all of that. Again, I guess I'm just wanting to make the point that you were making, Alex, about it's not a question of black-white thinking. It's a question of how do we live with that complexity? How do we try and understand and, in our limited ways, act in a what we think of as an ethical way? How difficult that is, how difficult it is to understand ourselves, let alone anybody else.
Thanks, Lane. It's definitely so. I you know, limited time, the whole structure of the novel, I think you're calling attention to, there are disconcerting time shifts and shift in voices and perspectives. It's not written in a linear style. And so the very structure of the novel is very much like Alex described, with, you know, these shifting perspectives, and you think you kind of have it, and then it's something else, and it's really you have to work with the novel. It's very gripping, but it's an experience in itself of just what Alex was talking about, or something pretty similar to that. But yeah, then it invokes the experience in you of that very question of oneself, you know, of the reader, of the listener. I was reading just this morning a little something. I was talking about the problem of plurality in life now, you know, different groups, you know, kind of the old liberal view of many groups living together in all differences. But that also implies your truth can't be the complete truth, because and that's what drives people crazy, and that's why they're always, you know, it's the techniques that are used to find someone to blame for the anxiety than trying to, you know, grossly simplify. No, I think that, that sense of not knowing, I mean, that's the enigma. That's whatever the ultimate enigma is, that's a very, very core and deep point. Thank you, Lane.
John?
Does shame dance with dehiscence? And if so, how?
The shame what?
Dance with dehiscence. And if so, how?
Oh, I think I think anything can be danced with. In a way, the dance then makes it more part of you in some kind of organic way and experiential way. I would think it wouldn't be a light dance, though. It might be a horrifying dance. It might be a danse macabre. you know, I mean, you know, there are all different kinds of dances. It wouldn't be a dance of light and beauty, although, you know, maybe there'd be glimpses. You might get there and be like a dancing butterfly. You know, that's almost, for the dancer, that's almost, to float above reality is almost, you know, a goal with, you know, with a really great dancer that rise above the earth. But yeah, no, I think you dancing with anything, that's the human thing in a way, to be able to dance with what is. But that means slowing down and being with it and totally, you know, sense it transcends ego or structures or anything. Yeah. Yeah.
Ladson, I was in Mexico drinking margaritas when the election results started to come in, and as the evening began to go downhill, became more shocked and depressed. My thoughts ran to Dietrich Bonhoeffer in Germany, part of the plot to kill Hitler. He was a German clergyman, as you know. And I recall in seminary, we were all shocked that he could, in fact, participate in a murder. And it leads me to wonder out loud with you and the rest, how can we not act in the presence of what's going on? Because it seems to me that would be the most unethical thing. The answer might be that we have to go beyond believing this is good or evil, but simply having to do what we have to do and cannot stand aside. Would you comment on that?
Well, I guess a little bit. You know, that's deep stuff there, Mel. Thank you for that. I like deep stuff. I like stuff that makes me crazy. I'm very perverse. So, you know, guilt in a way is about ethics a lot, guilt and morality and kind of a logical code, thou shalt not kill, or so forth and so on. Can you come from a place, is it possible to come from a place that's a totally creative and spontaneous act? And those are fairly rare, probably, that it's a question of coming from a place that's free of all the context, all the chains of associations and cultural and personal way that we're all embedded in. Is it possible to have a spontaneous act of freedom? Does the human being have that capacity? A lot of people would say that human beings don't have that. I think it gets down to that, you know, the kind of the limitations of human freedom, and you know, is it possible? It's possible to come from a place that's before all that, that's just pure there-ness. But I don't know. I'd like to, what do you think? I know you have all kinds of thoughts about this stuff.
I think we have to be able to set aside a belief that we can know the rightness or wrongness of the act, and in a moment have to, out of some place beyond good and evil, to simply have to do what has to be done. I know my thought went when Trump got elected, immediately not only to Dietrich Bonhoeffer, but to the thought, maybe he'll be assassinated, and we'll get lucky. That in fact, this period of our history is not going to go the way it appears to be going, with incredible amount of pain unnecessary to our fellow citizens. I think the issue is, are we willing to act in some way about what we believe I must do, good or evil? This cannot be ignored, and you can't be passive. That's a guilty posture in my mind, not to respond.
I think response can be on many levels, so it doesn't have to be outer action. I think if you let the horror and the terror or whatever it is impact you, not be in denial of the reality, but also knowing it's totally enigmatic what you could do to affect it, and waiting for the right time, the kairos, or whatever you would call it, something like that. Mm-hmm. I think action, you were such an action-oriented culture, mm-hmm. I get a little dubious about action. But if that's denial or explaining it away, you know, that's not,
I wouldn't like I'm that. Dubious about waiting for the conclusion in history and look back and say, where were you while this was going on?
Yeah.
And the answer in my mind can't be, I don't know what to do.
Mm-hmm. Well, that would be the ego's discontent. I think, yeah, you could come from a place, it was horrible, and I went on, and there was never a right moment. But that would be honest and different. But the ego's sort of narcissistic bewilderment, oh, I'm imperfect, I didn't, you know, kind of like that sort of self-justifying thing. But, well, anyway, thank you. That's good stuff to think about.
Another question?
Yeah.
So what are you thinking for yourself? I think you're talking for many of us and thinking, okay, so it's time to stand up and be counted. Who knows what the result is, if all that would be. But what are you thinking? What was the, where did the question, where did Bonhoeffer come from for you?
I'm trying to find a way in to the conversation politically.
I'm not sitting on my hands and trying to make a decision. I think I know where I want to line up on this. But who can, in fact, help me get empowered such that we will not let this happen? I don't know the answer to that. What I do know is I can't not act. I'm trying to find out where it would be.
Maxine?
One of the things it seems to me is that this has wakened each of us up. I don't take the peaceful transition of power for granted anymore. And it feels to me that as alive and awake people, if we can keep our thinking minds and refrain from descending into excitement and mindless opposition, that we are more empowered, potentially empowered, than we may give ourselves credit for. I take a step back and think, if I can remain alert and alive and act in a way with responsible others, and it may be very locally, there are a variety of organizations that are suggesting how to impact our congresspeople and thus that branch of government. If I can do that and then recognize that the state of mind of a Trump who cannot think, who is bound to feel, bound to tell himself lies, because that's his reality, that somehow that state of mind will implode or explode at some point. And so if I try to stay awake and alive and use the reasonable powers within a democracy and not despair, that's, at least as I stand here right now, first steps forward.
Reminded of something a supervisor once said, Dr. Janes years ago, supervision. I'm trying to remember how this came up, but he said the hopeful result of an analysis is that one might become disillusioned, not disillusioned. And to go back to what Maxine was saying here, some other thoughts that I have about that, if one's disillusioned, you're more likely to act violently, which is Maxine's mindless opposition or excitement, and that if one were disillusioned, you're more likely to act with reason and nonviolently, which one might look at as a alert and alive and not to despair, at any rate. So that's something that came up from years ago.
Yeah, thank you, Phil.
Thank you. So from Lord Jim, how many years ago was it written?
116.
116 years ago. Here we are talking in a very profound way. It resonates with us.